I just thought while we've got Roz and this lovely man here as well, if anyone would have any other questions you'd like to ask of him, we just might spend a few minutes talking about that. if I could just get you to repeat the question after
I will.
Ask,
so I will.
That we can record it.
Yeah. Sir.
Oh, cool. I just have one question about biomarkers.
Yes.
Constantly on this biomarker roller coaster where we hear our research has come out and this is what's going wrong, chronic fatigue, we will have our biomarker, we're going to have our validation, but we never seem to quite get there. I'm just wondering what would it take to go from, you know, all this good research where we find that something is wrong in our initial metabolism cycle or in our VOX2 thresholds or the immune pathologies of the university. How would you get from that point to actually having a biomarker?
Well, I think there are a number, the question is, there are a lot of studies going on looking for biomarkers, but we're not seeming to come up with the final answer. Is that what the question is?
Yeah, or any tests we can go to our doctors.
Yeah, and that's true. There are a number of groups that are working on a particular biomarker. The problem is you have to test the biomarkers against normal healthy individuals and other conditions. So you have to know that the biomarker won't be positive in depression, in MS, in rheumatoid arthritis, in rheumatic conditions. And so it takes a lot of testing to do that. And many of them have fallen away when they start doing that kind of thing. So to date, I'm not aware of anyone that's passed all of those tests. They haven't been specific enough.
What about VOX2? It's been around for a while.
What about the
VOX2? So it's like that's anaerobic threshold tests.
The anaerobic threshold test. The problem with doing an anaerobic threshold test is it requires very expensive equipment. The equipment we have in our office was $90,000 just to do the threshold test, and you know practitioners are just not going to put that kind of equipment in their office to do it. Yeah. That's the other problem, is the cost of the equipment and whether the public health service is going to pay for it or not. Yes, sir. And then we'll come over on this side.
The recent report out of Australia, Griffith University, about the TRPM receptors being defective right across the CFS syndrome, it seems like it's similar to the cryptocytes, it's common to all cells.
I think so too, yeah. I think that there's... I think you all heard, because he's got a good booming voice, I think you all heard that. In Australia, they're doing some studies. They're looking for markers there also. It does seem to involve a lot of the Krebs cycle work as well. That's why I'm so enthusiastic about it. That's why I wanted to share that with you. So as you read more about it, maybe it will make more sense to you. So I appreciate you bringing that up. Yeah. And I hope they're successful with it. Yes, ma'am.
I was wondering if there were any brain imaging help with diagnostics. Does it show neural inflammation or?
Yes, the question is, are there any brain imaging studies that are helpful? And yes, I shared that with the physicians. 80% of our patients have abnormal MRIs. They have little areas of inflammation on the MRI. And so that shows neuroinflammation, and there are oxidative changes that we see too. And then when we do SPECT scan, which measures blood flow, we know that the blood flow is reduced in the temporal lobes and in the diencephalon or the midbrain. So yes, there are a lot of studies that way, but again, they're very expensive and they're investigative studies. They're not the sort of thing that a GP would generally order.
This might be a bit morbid, but are there any post-mortem investigations that have been done on chronic fatigue people to see if there are any changes in the brain?
I'm not aware that there are any post-mortem brain studies that are done, because those have to be done within minutes of death, and that means that the brain has to be harvested immediately after death. So usually those are done at hospitals. We do those at Duke Hospital, for example, where I'm on the faculty, and we have a whole department where people who are dying go there when they're terminally ill and they want to will their brains. And the moment they die, they're taken to the autopsy suite and and the brain is harvested, but it has to be done within minutes because the brain is like jello, and if you don't harvest it right away, it's impossible to get any data from it. So the answer, that's a grim thing to think about. What is your brain? Here we were having such a good time. I know. No, I'm not aware of any studies that were done like that. The only thing that comes close to it is years ago there was a thought that a lot that goes on in the brain is very similar to what happens in post-polio syndrome. And there was one of our colleagues that studied post-polio syndrome, and as those patients got older, you know, these are patients that got polio in the 1950s, and they're now senior citizens and passing away, and as they pass away, we do get brain slices from them and can study that, and it's helping a little bit, but we don't really get a lot from that. Yes, ma'am.
In regard to the top 10 list, patients that you've seen, if they did practice all that, are you talking about becoming, say, 100% better, or just improving from their present state?
No, over the years, these are things that I have found that have worked best for patients. Yeah, so being a very compliant patient and doing all of these things isn't going to guarantee improvement. It's just, these are things that have helped patients a lot in the past. Yes?
Hi, I was just wondering if you had any experience in what the conclusions were of treating these diseases with HRT and also marijuana.
So the lady is asking about treatment with HRT, which is hormone replacement therapy, and marijuana.
And or.
Just to make it more tricky. Well, hormonal replacement therapy is helpful in a number of patients, I think. Because the hypothalamus and the pituitary are suppressed in our patients, and so women tend to have very low estrogen levels and will go into menopause prematurely, and will have a lot of menopausal symptoms, early hot flushes and emotionality and things like that. And so by using hormonal replacement, many women will feel a lot better. So it certainly is worth a try. As far as the marijuana is concerned, you may know that about, I think it's up to 30 states in the United States, marijuana is now available legally. From a state perspective, it's not legal federally, but for the states allow patients to use it. And many of them come to our office and have found that the marijuana, if it's smoked or vaped or eaten, it can be helpful with nausea, and it can be helpful with pain in particular. The problem with it has been the dosing. We don't know what doses to use, and sometimes it's not so much for medicinal uses as for recreational uses, if you know what I mean. The other thing is, the more serious concern is that marijuana does interfere with other medications, much as alcohol can interfere with other medications too. And I don't think it's been totally worked out how marijuana does interfere with other medications. So there could be side effects, in other words, if you were using it willy-nilly and not being very cautious with it. The third problem that we've had with marijuana, it's not legal in North Carolina, so I don't personally use it. I'm just passing on the secondhand the experience that I've heard. The third problem is that most patients find that they develop tolerance to it, that it doesn't work after a while. Yeah. Now, having said that, in all 50 of the United States, cannabidiol or CBD oil is legal. So you can get CBD oil in all 50 of our states, and that can be rubbed on. So if you have joints or if you have muscles that hurt, you can rub CBD oil, and that has been helpful. But again, we don't know how that interacts with other medications because it is absorbed through the skin. But it has no, it doesn't have any THC, and it doesn't have any psychedelic potential to it. So it's safe to use.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Just one point on that. I know some people use marijuana just to get sleep rather than necessarily for pain, especially, and also fellas, because they sleep and the pain is given.
Yes, yeah, treating the pain will help the sleep. That's exactly right. I said I would take your question and then your question. Yes.
I was just wondering, there's things you talk about work in Australia on calcium ion channel deficits.
I'm sorry, say that again, please.
Been some information come out recently on the studies in Australia on calcium ion channel deficits.
Yes.
I'm just wondering if there's any connection between this and the Krebs cycle.
The question is there any relationship between the Krebs cycle and calcium ion channels? Well, there are several different calcium ion channels, and I'm not aware that any are related to the Krebs cycle, no. Some of them control pain, for example, that's how gabapentin and pregabalin work, is through alpha-delta channels, calcium channels. There's calcium channel blockers that are used for high blood pressure as well. That's another calcium channel. So there are a number of different calcium channels. And the calcium channel blockers that work on hypertension also can increase blood flow to the brain. So we use drugs like amlodipine and Nimetop to increase blood flow to the brain, which sometimes helps in chronic fatigue syndrome a little bit. But I'm not aware of any relationship to the Krebs cycle, no. Okay, your question in the back. Yes, ma'am.
Between multiple chemical sensitivities and chronic fatigue syndrome, and what, because I've tried to sort of do a bit of my own research and it's really limited, and also the sort of my GP's knowledge of MCS is very limited, and so I'm sort of struggling, so I'm grappling with now two problems, and I wondered if there was anything that you knew about sort of the interlinking between the two. And because I was diagnosed with chronic fatigue many years ago, and then I've now been diagnosed with MCS, but I'm just trying to figure out. I was interested to see that there was a link, because that's what I assumed there would be, but I wondered if you knew what the background was there, or the why.
So you're asking basically about the correlation of multiple chemical sensitivities and chronic fatigue syndrome, ME, is that correct?
Why does it make you more predisposed if if you've got chronic fatigue? You're obviously more. There is a link, but why are you more predisposed for that? Is there any understanding around the why?
I don't think anybody knows why people are predisposed to chronic fatigue syndrome. We just know that if you have chronic fatigue syndrome, that 67% of people that have chronic fatigue syndrome meet criteria for multiple chemical sensitivities, and that about 35% of people who have multiple chemical sensitivities will meet criteria for chronic fatigue syndrome in reverse. But we don't know what the common thread is between the two, unfortunately. Yeah, and I'm not an expert on multiple chemical sensitivities, so I can teach you everything I know in about 3 minutes.
Sort of know if there was anything that I hadn't read already, on those lineages.
Yeah, wish I could help you more on that one.
That's okay.
Yeah, yeah. Yes?
I just want to ask if you've got patients that have come up with red blood cell distortion, either the red blood cell is too large or that it's an odd shape, it's not totally round. But the iron levels are still the same, so the doctors just...
The question is, do patients with chronic fatigue syndrome have distorted red blood cells? And we had...
Dr. Les Simpson in Otago.
Yes, Dr. Simpson in Otago studied that extensively and found that the red blood cells were larger in the sense that they were spherical, and so the sed rate tended to be very low in patients with chronic fatigue syndrome. But I don't think that the RDW, I don't think that the shape of the cells was different. It was just...
Some of them were a bit distorted, but probably because they died sooner.
Say that again?
Some of them were distorted, he thought, because they deteriorated quicker.
Did you hear that? Some of them were distorted because they deteriorated quicker. And Les Simpson did a lot of work on that, hematologist in Otago, right here, yeah. So that's what we know about red blood cells. Okay, let's see. I guess we can go in the back here, and then we'll get over to you.
Have you seen patients that have been really unwell for decades get well again?
Have I seen patients get well again?
After being unwell for a very long time, like decades.
Oh, yes, yeah. Have I seen patients get well after they've been ill? Yes, absolutely. We see all kinds of patterns. The prognosis is that about, in several longitudinal studies that have been done in chronic fatigue syndrome, about 10% recover, about 37% improve, and then the rest are sort of all over the map, except in young people. If you're an adolescent with chronic fatigue syndrome, up to 80% improve there. So, you know, very variable what we see happen. And I have seen patients totally recover after years of being very, very ill. So I tell people always be hopeful, and especially with these new treatments that we're looking at now. I think it's very positive. I don't think it's ever been as positive as it is right now. So I'm telling everybody to be very, very hopeful at this point.
During my chronic fatigue and FM journey, it's come up a lot that a lot of people have had glandular fever.
Yes.
That's what we hear a lot in New Zealand. Just wondering what your comments and experiences are, the correlation.
Yes, it's a good point. We don't know what causes chronic fatigue syndrome. There's no one agent that we know that causes cognitive difficulties, causes muscles to aches, causes sore throats, swollen glands, fevers, causes the GI problem. You know, all these different symptoms that we see in chronic fatigue, there's no one explanation for that to date. What we do know is that 85% of the cases that we see seem to follow some sort of a viral-like onset. And then another 10 or 15% follow a traumatic type of onset, which could be a surgery or a slip on the ice or a fender bender, something like that. So there are a number of different causes, but the vast majority are an infectious type of cause. That said, we've never found one infectious agent that does it. There have been two studies on triggers of chronic fatigue syndrome. What did people recall as the cause of their illness? One was by Dr. Safford in Toronto, and the other was Dr. Demarier in Belgium. Both of them, as I recall, studied about 100 patients each, and they both concluded that the vast majority were infectious in onset. I thought it was interesting that they both pointed out that the vast majority of patients were under a great deal of stress when they felt ill, which led to a theory early on that stress sort of walked people up to the top of a hill, and then they would get an infectious illness and that would push them over. So it was the infection that was the straw that broke the camel's back, so to speak. Now, that said, probably the most common infection that we see is the Epstein-Barr or the glandular fever. That's the most common that we see, but I've seen Lyme disease, I've seen tuberculosis, I've seen staphylococcal infections, I've seen all kinds of infections trigger it off, not necessarily any one particular infection to do it. So I don't know if I answered your question, but I tried. Yes, sir.
Just two things. What was the reason you said for lying reclining versus lying down?
Why is it better to recline? I'm implying this from a Johns Hopkins study. At Johns Hopkins, they did a study with patients who had who were healthy controls and who had, and these were young people who had chronic fatigue syndrome. And they had them lie flat and then they elevated the legs. And by elevating the legs, they stretched the nerves by elevating the legs, okay? And I think it was just 15 minutes that they, it wasn't very long that they elevated. So when they stretched the legs in the patients, it triggered a flare the next day. But by stretching the legs a similar amount in the healthy controls, it didn't trigger a flare. And the conclusion from that was that that puts traction. It stretches the spinal cord and the nerves in the legs by about 6 to 9 millimeters, as I recall. And they thought that doing that traction was enough to cause inflammation in the nerve. So if you're sitting in bed and your feet are straight out in front of you, that's causing traction on the nerves. And that's why they think that sitting in bed is not as good as or lying in bed is not as good as having a kink in your knee, having your knee partially bent. So that reduces the traction on that nerve. Does that make sense? Yeah. And apparently there have been some very good studies using MRI scans to show that when you sit in a recumbent position, like in a recliner, that there is less traction on those nerves. I don't know who has the time to take those kind of studies, but someone does apparently. Let's do one more question and then we'll call it a day.
Oh, very interested in the comments on the antibody against the Krebs cycle enzyme.
Yes.
With antibodies, you know, they're a defense mechanism in the body, and once you've had an infection and the antibodies are there, you know, you've got the antibodies, if sometime in the future you get the same thing presented, you're all ready for it. But
yes.
With the Krebs cycle enzyme, it's in the body all the time. It's never ever going to go away.
Yes.
And so they saw this, I mean, they use like chemotherapy, right? Just basically blitz out those B cells so that you then got rid of the antibody producing cells.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a bit of a real heavy hammer approach. Are you aware? I mean, once you've got this, if you've got a antibody being produced to something it's kind of like an autoimmune disease, isn't it, right? And you've been producing antibodies to something that is a natural part of your body. Are you aware of any therapies where they can re-educate the immune system to not do this sort of destructive stuff?
I am not.
Other than whacking it out with the heavy chemotherapy.
That's a very good question. No. But you bring up a good point. Is it, why would the body start attacking PDH like that? And but that's exactly the problem in chronic fatigue syndrome, is that it is an autoimmune disorder. Patients with chronic fatigue syndrome develop autoantibodies to the thyroid, to parietal cells in the stomach, to nuclear cells, our own cells. So we develop anti-nuclear antibodies in up to 80% of cases. So, and there are many, many more. In fact, that was one of the studies that a couple of our colleagues are interested in doing, is doing a matrix to find out how many autoantibodies are typically seen in patients with chronic fatigue syndrome. So for some reason, patients with chronic fatigue syndrome turn against themselves, and why that happens, we don't know. But the only way that we know to control it right now is to stop the production of the autoantibodies with either steroids or by something like rituximab that wipes out the B cells that are making them. I don't know of any other way myself. But I'm not an immunologist. Maybe Nancy Klimas could do better, but I don't know of anything else that she's doing. So,
nobody's mentioned the microbiome, which I'm surprised about.
Yeah, so.
Right, well, we could keep asking you lots of questions.
We could, so couldn't we, huh?
Honestly, you'd still be around afterwards if you'd like to ask anything else. On behalf of Ansmes and Emmy Auckland, I would like to present you with this New Zealand gift.
Well, thank you.
As a thank you for all your time And as someone...
Is it a puppy?
With CME, yes, very similar to a puppy.
Is it a kiwi?
No, it's a deer. and as someone with ME, I'd just like to say thank you so much for the amount of understanding and information that you've shown today.
Well, thank you.
It really means a lot to me. I've had this illness since I was 19, so I have lived with it all my life.
It's exciting to see. You can't tell by looking at a person, can you?
Well, this is right, yeah. Mm.
So thank you all for having me. It's been a pleasure.
Yes.
Hope it helped.